Thank you, Julian. What a guy. I don't know how come I never got here. I used to live over here in Cleveland, but I guess I left Cleveland just shortly after this conference began. I moved south about 12 years ago. But here I am, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you very much. As Julian says, he better get off and let me get on with this, because he knows. I was told to limit my talk tonight, so I will just spend the first hour and a half talking about myself. The second hour, I'll talk about the program. It's certainly wonderful to see a crowd like this gathered together, and you look so grand out there. I wish everyone could see you from this vantage point. Anytime I see a good-looking bunch like this together, it always reminds me of a story. I'm not too much of a storyteller, but this one story I do like, and this always reminds me of it. It's about Jerry, the town drunk. Maybe some of you folks have heard this story. This Jerry, he had never been seen sober. Many, many years, he was drunk all the time. And Jerry was... He always had a dirty beard. He never had a haircut. He was filthy. His feet were, bare feet were on the ground. There's holes in his britches, and he stunk. This was normal for Jerry. He's always drunk. Time went on, many years went on, and finally Jerry turned up his toes and died. And this presented a problem in the town. They had to bury him. He had no one who would claim him. So the town had to get together, and they got an undertaker who furnished a casket and got him a new suit and shaved him up and cleaned him up real nice. And they got him prepared for burial. Then they had to get a preacher to take care of the funeral sermon. It was kind of a tough job to get a preacher to do this job. Finally, they got one. And this preacher, he came up there to give the funeral sermon, oration. And he was stumped. He just didn't know quite what to say. So he says, "Well, folks," he says, I admit, I just don't know what to say about Jerry. You all knew him. We all knew him here. We knew him for what he was. He says, "But I'd just like you all to do one thing." He says, "I'd like you all to come up here and take a good look at Jerry and see how good he looks since he quit drinking." I think this happens to all of us in a more or less degree. I'm glad we all didn't have to die to get this compliment. People change very quickly in AA when they come here. I think every person here is a miracle, every one of us. I know in my case, it had to be a miracle that I ever arrived here. I'd like to tell you just how I did get into this fellowship. As Julian mentioned, I had my 25th anniversary last February. And at that time, there was no AA. This is the way we do things. Everything starts backwards. This was not known as AA in those days. And I got in it, see? No AA, but I got in it. I was on the bum, and I was having trouble at home, and my wife was giving me my last chance to make good at home. And this was on the premise that I should go to work for her brother, bless his heart. This was quite a family I was mixed up with in those days. This is not the wife I have now, I might say without... I won't have to mention that. He drove a truck. He had a truck that ran between Cleveland and New York. And they told me that if I would take a job as his assistant and learn how to drive this truck, that I could prove to them that I wasn't this drunken so-and-so that they were all calling me and accusing me of being, why, they'd give me another chance at home. So there's nothing I could do but accept this challenge. Now, I'm a fellow who does not believe in work. I never did. And getting sober hasn't changed this very much either. But the idea of driving one of those big outfits was really out of this world. But I had to go ahead with this deal. So I told him I would, so away we went. This was in the fall of the year. And we headed for New York. I didn't arrive in New York sober. I got away from him in Albany. And I remember this. I remember that Albany was the capital of New York, and I suddenly developed a keen desire to see the government buildings. He had to take a nap that evening, so I got out and got away from him. And you know what happened. But I got back, and he was sleeping on the seat there, and I stepped on the poor boy's face getting up into the sleeping part of the cab, and he knew what was wrong. He carried me out of New York and threw me out on the waterfront, and there I was. Well, I had no money, I had no clothes, I had no nothing. But I had a sister-in-law, another sister of his, bless her heart, in Yonkers. And she used to think I was pretty good. She always used to refer to me as her favorite brother-in-law. This was some time before this, however. And I went out to see Virginia, thought maybe she'd look after me. Here I was in a town of 7 or 8 million people, and I didn't know a soul. I made my way out to Yonkers, and I remembered I'd gone there on my honeymoon when we first gotten married, so I knew that she lived way up on top of a hill. When I got out there, I didn't go up on a hill. I went down a hill and got in this Italian section down there. And I met some very nice people. And they were drinking wine. And you know what happened. By the time I got up to Virginia's place, I was really potted. I was boiled. And I can only remember one thing about this trip to Virginia's house. I was rolling around on the floor with her two kids. She didn't like this. She took a dim view of this, and she put me in the back of her car and drove me down to that waterfront and dumped me out where her brother had dumped me. So I was in New York without a dime, without a friend, without anything, period. And a winter setting in. I don't know how long I stayed in New York. It's not important, but I existed there a long, long time. I tell this story for this reason, that eventually, this played a big part in my coming into AA. It seems that some time later, Virginia had her doctor over about one of the kids, and they got to talking about drinking. And she told this doctor about this drunken brother-in-law of hers, and what a nice guy he used to be and what a slob he is now. And the doctor says, you know, that's odd. He says, I used to have a drunken brother-in-law like that, too. But he met some cult or other. And they do nothing but, he does nothing but run around fixing drunks. And besides this brother-in-law, there's a doctor down in Akron, Ohio, who's in this strange cult, and he spends all his time doing this. And this doctor suggested that if I should ever land back in Cleveland, maybe they could send me to this doctor down there, and maybe he could fix me. Well, he was referring to Dr. Smith, Dr. Bob, Doc Smith, in Akron. This doctor Virginia was talking to happened to be Dr. Leonard Strong, who is Bill Wilson's brother-in-law. Now, at that time, there was no AA. There were probably a half a dozen, 6, 8, 10 people had ever been exposed to this plan through the old Oxford group. Sometime later, I got back to Cleveland. I got a ride back with another truck driver. And he took me to Erie, and from Erie I beat my way in, and I got back home, and I tried to get in the nest, but it didn't work. The little woman met me at the door. And she was pleasant enough, so long as I was outside. And she told me about this doctor in Akron, Ohio, and asked me if I'd like to go down and see him. So what could I lose? Sure, I'll go down and see him. So she bought me a one-way bus ticket, put me on a bus and sent me to Akron. And this was my first meeting with Doc Smith. Now, the first time I went down there, I got down there very early in the morning. And it was a winter time. Everything happens to me in zero weather. I don't know why this is. It's always lousy weather when anything happens to me. And I got into this Second National Bank building in Akron. I went up to the floor where Doc's office was, and he wasn't in. And I can recall, I was afraid to leave the building. It was warm in there, but I was afraid to get out I'd never get back again. So I stayed there, and I paraded up and down in front of that up in that lobby in front of his door for what seemed an awful long time. And I was wondering what this doctor was going to do to me and what about him and so forth and so on. I was all shaky. I was sick. I hadn't had a drink that morning. And I can remember every time I walked past his office door there, I'd read his name on the door. It says, Dr. Robert Holbrook Smith, rectal surgeon. This is the guy that's going to fix me. Well, you know, by the time you arrive at the place in your drinking career that I was at that time, you're ready for anything. And this, in my fogged up way, didn't seem unreasonable. Finally, Doc came in, and he ushered me through a couple offices into his back room. And I was prepared to tell him all about my symptoms and my troubles, but he didn't allow me to do this. He took the ball away from me and he told me all about himself, and all about, which actually was my story. And I figured he was talking about me all the time. And I couldn't figure out how this guy knew so much about me. I'd never seen him before. And I got suspicious. Now, there are people here from Cleveland. They may remember this. Some of the older people from Cleveland that are older in years. At that time, they were having a what they called the torso murder mysteries in Cleveland. They were finding bits of bodies wrapped in newspaper over in Kingsbury Run. And they never identified any of these bodies except finally one. There was a woman they found. There were seven or eight men's bodies that they found all cut up. But they identified this woman because her fingerprints. It was the only woman that was involved in the deal. But she had fingerprints. She'd had a police record. But these men, they never identified. And the newspapers at that time assumed that this, they called him the Mad Butcher of Kingsbury Run, whoever this character was. They figured he was either a butcher or a doctor that had gone berserk. And the reason they figured out, because he knew a lot about anatomy. He had a good technique in cutting up these bodies. He's doing this for kicks. And this doctor, knowing so much about me, he was all for putting me in a goonie roost out in Cuyahoga Falls, where he, as he explained, people couldn't get to me. Well, about this time, this was going through my head, and I was all for people getting to me. So I up and beat it on him. I saw my chance, and I ran out of his office and beat it and disappeared. But you know, I could never forget this man. Something happened to me. And sometime later, I was sitting there in a bottle gang. I was with a bunch of jugheads I used to drink with, and we got talking about one of our favorite subjects. I think I started at this time. We got start talking about quitting drinking. And this was a high spot in my drinking career, this particular get-together, this little tete-a-tete we had. As I remember, I brought this thing out. I told him that I was going to quit drinking. And this brought evoked a lot of response. One blabbermouth fella in particular. And now remember, we're all drunk. This is the kettle calling the pot black and so forth. This one blabbermouth, he says, you'll never quit drinking. He says, you don't have guts enough to quit drinking. I says, I'll show you. I know a doctor down in Akron will fix me. He says, nobody can fix me. You're no good. He says, quit drinking, he says, takes determination. He says, to have determination, you need a chin. He says, you got a chin like Andy Gump. You're no good. I says, I'll show you. And you know, I think this was the last vestige of pride that I had left in me. I had to do something about it. So I got a hold of someone's phone. If I live to be 1,000, I'll probably never find out whose it was. But someone got a fine phone bill because all these calls to Akron are long distance. And I don't know whose phone it was because we didn't have phones where we were. But somebody got a swell bill because Doc told me I called him numerous times that day. I only remember calling him once. But he told me to meet him at Akron City Hospital in the morning, and I did. I made it down there. And that was my beginning of this way of life. Now, things were quite a bit different in those days than they are now. As I said before, this was not known as AA at that time. This was known as the Oxford Group. And we had a lot of different little things we went through in the Oxford Group, forms and ceremonies that we don't have in AA today. But that was my beginning, and I went to Akron for 15 months. And I missed two meetings in all that time. I used to spend a lot of time on weekends with those people. Either I'd be down there or they'd be in Cleveland. After 15 months, we started our first group in Cleveland. And we had about a dozen fellas who were going to Cleveland. Some of them had wives. And we had quite a contingent that went down there every week. And there was there's difficulties coming up between the alcoholics and the earth people, the Oxford Group people. There was frictions, and there were a lot of reasons why alcoholics had to be by themselves and break away from this. During 1938, I came in February 38, during the fall of 38, the book was written, and the 12 steps were written. And the book was published in February of 39. When we started our group in Cleveland, we started it as Alcoholics Anonymous. We took the name from the book. Cleveland, Ohio was the first group that started as Alcoholics Anonymous. New York and Akron started in the Oxford group, and they eventually switched into the AA name. So that's something, a little history you Clevelanders probably can take home with you. At any rate, we started on a different basis. In the Oxford group, we used to operate on the four principles of the four absolutes of absolute honesty, unselfishness, purity, and love. When the AA book was written, the 12 steps were written. 12 steps were written as a way of life, a way to change a person's life. It was felt that the only way an alcoholic could recover was by a complete change of his life. You know, this thing of alcoholism, let's talk about it in a moment. It's an old, old thing. Alcoholism is as old as history's recorded. We read about the exploits of alcoholics in the Bible. We read about it in ancient history. We read about it way back. Read about Noah. Even old Noah got potted. Remember that story. Now, this is a long time ago. And all these years, things have been tried to change this thing of alcoholism. Cure alcoholics, help them, shoot them, anything. A lot of things have been tried. But nothing was ever successful until about the last 25 years or so. It's the last few years. Now, why is this? You know, alcoholism to me is, some people, they have some very peculiar notions about what it is. You hear people talk about it being a habit. It's not a habit. We could break any habit we have. We never could break alcoholism as a habit. Some people talk about alcoholism being a matter of a taste. Holy smokes, if you think this is a taste, if anyone's got that notion, I wish they'd try some of this stuff I was drinking at the end. I paid 7 cents a pint for my booze, and I bought it in a wallpaper store. Believe me, I didn't drink this for its palatable qualities. It's neither a habit nor is it a taste. If it were a habit or a taste, we wouldn't lose our families, our jobs, our friends, everything that's near and dear to us. Not by a long shot. Alcoholism is an obsession. It's a condition of the mind. It's an illness. It's an illness, however, that I'm quite sure we'll never discover a pill or a potion that will ever cure. Alcoholism has to be handled in a different way. All these years, these many, many years, people, you and I have had the same treatment. We've had all this good advice. People have given me some of the finest advice. I've had $1 million worth of good advice before I ever got to AA. People told me if I didn't quit drinking, what was going to happen to me? And boy, they were right. See? But it happened. It didn't stop me. And they told you the same thing. They told me what was going to happen to my liver. They told me what was going to happen to my head. What's going to happen to this? What's going to happen? Am I going to lose my job? Am I going to lose my family? Am I going to lose my self-respect? Am I going to lose everything? I did. So what? I wanted to get out of this thing of alcoholism. I couldn't. You know, all these people who have tried, and there's a lot of people still trying, and why they fail with us, with you and I as alcoholics. One big reason why they fail is they assume that you and I are logical thinking creatures. Every time, I hope there's not one here, but every time I get up on one of these podiums and I see that sign think on there, I turn it over. I don't want to offend anyone. They think that we can think. An alcoholic don't think. An alcoholic feels. And he never acts on anything until he feels a certain way. So the program of Alcoholics Anonymous has to change us in the way we feel about things, about ourselves and about everything else. We are an emotional people. We act on emotions, not on sound judgment. That's something that a lot of people never find out. That's why so many of these programs fail with alcoholics. And that's why you and I, in AA, are able to transmit something or communicate with an alcoholic successfully. This is the doggonest outfit in the world. You walk into an AA meeting, you meet a bunch of people you've never seen before in your life, and in 10 minutes you're telling them all your secrets, things you wouldn't even tell your mother, and everybody laughs about it. See? This is something. You know, you have to be a total failure before you're qualified to get in here. I got a big kick out of one time. I happen to be a salesman. I work for an insurance company. And you know how these insurance outfits are? Any of you fellas that have been in the sales field know that they are the exponents of the biggest bunch of bull in the world. And we have these conventions every year, and they get all the men in to the home office, and they want to tell you what's going to happen next year and what you're supposed to do and all the new stuff coming out. And they give you, they wine you and dine you and show you a big time, make you feel like a big wheel. But they always do one thing. They always have a high-powered speaker to talk to the men. I remember a couple of years ago, I was up to home office, and they really had a honey. This boy was really something they had up there. He was a man from General Motors, and he spent all his time going around talking to sales organizations. And he really had a pitch that really stopped them all. But today he was talking about success. And he went on and on talking about eat success, think success, dream success, everything is success. He just pounded that success thing home, boom, 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 see? And then he winds up and he says, you never heard of anybody standing up in front of a bunch of people and bragging about being a failure, did you? I says, Buster, I got news for you. This is the one fellowship in the world where we do everything. If we do everything diametrically opposite of what we would in good business practice, we make a huge success. And that's about right. This thing of alcoholism, it only affects certain people. There's a lot of people who can never become one of us, no matter how hard they try. I think the privilege of being an alcoholic is reserved for a chosen few. I used to drink with a lot of jugheads who drank an awful lot of whiskey and booze and different kinds of things. They are not alcoholics. They can quit whenever they find some hobby that's more engaging. But not us. Not us. No siree. I know this because I've proven this. The alcoholic is a breed of cats all his own. And as I say, everybody can't make this league. This is a real exclusive league. And I get a big kick out of a lot of these birds that I've met around in AA. Some of these fellows who have drank themselves down to their last second yacht or something like this. And other people I meet, well, take some people outside of AA. They belong to some fancy country club. They pay $5,000-$10,000 for a membership and probably cost them $2,000 or $5,000 a year to belong to it. And they think they really belong to something great, you know? And probably it is, you know. But did you ever stop to figure out what your entrance requirement is to get into this league? Anybody who get in here under $50,000 is sneaked in. Believe me, I value my membership here. And it's a wonderful thing, and it is a miracle that we're all here. If you don't think this is a miracle, think about this sometime. Go home and think about this. Of all these years that we've been drinking, and all these years that these alcoholics have been walking across the face of the earth for centuries, just a few thousand of us in the last few years have had this opportunity. And there's millions of others who will probably never have this chance that'll follow us. But why did you and I get this chance? This is a miracle. It's something for us to think about. I think it'll give us a place a new value on our membership here if we consider this seriously. We are the chosen people. They talk about the Jews being the chosen people. That's hogwash. We are the chosen people. We are. Where would you ever find a fellowship like this? The outgiving and the outpouring of love that we find in here. I belong to organizations and clubs and lodges and veterans groups and things such as that. I like them. I enjoy them. But they have no relationship to what the spirit is in a fellowship such as ours, in our fellowship here. There's nothing like it. And you and I have this privilege. Now, how about this alcoholic fellow? I mentioned a moment ago that I think he's a different breed of cats than anyone else. And I don't think everyone can be one. I think you have to have certain characteristics to be an alcoholic. There are drunks and there are alcoholics. Every alcoholic is a drunk, but every drunk is not an alcoholic by a long shot. Believe me, because I've laid drunk with all of them. Now, the alcoholic, I think you can pigeonhole him by characteristics. I've never seen an alcoholic yet who was not a high-strung individual. This alcoholic is a very sensitive soul. He's always going around looking for someone to hurt his feelings. He's like a big kid. We feel, we cry. I see in this fellowship, I've never seen this happen in any lodge meetings I've been in or veterans meetings. They talk about some horrible things in veterans meetings sometimes about their poor old buddies. I never see a guy cry. How many guys have you seen crying here? It's not unusual for a fellow to break all up in this fellowship, and a girl. We're sensitive people. We're like a bunch of kids. Something different in here. The alcoholic is the biggest liar that ever wore shoes. He's a conniver and he's a thief. I would steal a red hot stove. Anything. I used to bring home some of the oddest trinkets for which I would have no use whatsoever, but when I was picking them up, I thought perhaps sometime there may be some need for this. But I'd bring it along with me. Some of the doggonest things I used to collect of other people's. But the alcoholic is an extremist. He never does anything by halfway measures. It's whole hog or nothing with the rummy. He's an idealist also. You probably wouldn't think so sometimes, but he is. He is really an idealist. He's a great guy, and he wants to have fun. He's really a social creature, and he's been so lonesome, and so he's just been discarded by anyone, and he's been booted out, and he's rejected. He's lonely. I was never so lonely in my life as when I came to on that waterfront in New York with the realization that I had not one friend, there was not one person in the world who cared whether I lived or died. This is an awful feeling. I shall never forget it. Today, I have thousands of friends. It's wonderful. People make a fuss over us. They accept us. They love us. We do for one another. We don't expect too much of each other. But the love is here. I have never seen a fellowship like this. I don't like to hear AA spoken of as an organization. It's a fellowship. It's a fellowship of the redeemed. Now, since we know that alcoholism has been around a long time, we know something about who the alcoholic is and the rummy. What do we do about it? All these things have been tried. We've been persuaded, we've been cussed, we've been discussed, we've been kissed, we've been kicked, we've been damned, we've been praised, we've been hired, we've been fired, we've been rehired and refired. Everything's happened to us. People have lectured us. People have thrown us out. People have taken us back in. Everything. We build things up and it all goes down again. What happens? How can we work with a fellow like this? What can we do? AA has the answer in these 12 steps of ours. I'll spend the next hour and a half on the 12 steps. In the Oxford group, people were always talking about life-changing. The Oxford group were a bunch of people who were of a religious persuasion. They were trying to live better lives by Christian principles, by good spiritual principles. And they felt that by adopting and accepting these principles and surrendering their wills and their lives to the care of God, they would live differently, they'd be different people. Which was true. One of the greatest things that ever happened to me was after a meeting in Akron one night, one of the boys came to me, this Bill Van Horn. He's dead now, all those fellas are gone. Bill came to me, and Bill was a great, maybe some of you folks around Ohio knew him. He was a terrific guy. Bill had, it was a great big husky fellow, and he had been, he was on a small pension from the First World War. And when he get that pension the first of the month, he always would really go on a tear, and he thought he could whip the police department in Kent and in Akron. And this he couldn't do, but he kept trying. And he had so many nightsticks laid over his head that he got silly. And finally, the folks, they couldn't put up with this anymore, and they had Bill probated. They put him in the Maslin State Insane Asylum, and they threw the key away on him. That's where Doc Smith found Bill. And Bill wasn't any nuttier than the rest of us, only when he drank, he was like an Indian. He'd go, bleh. But when he was sober, he was a fine guy. So Doc got him out of there and put him in the group in Akron. And for some reason or other, Bill preceded me by about 6 months in the group, and for some reason or other, he took a great shine to me. He used to spend a lot of time with me after meetings. And one night he came to me after a meeting, he says, Clarence, he says, I'm going to give you the answer to this whole thing. He says, I'm going to give you something. I want you to read this. I want you to memorize it. I don't want you to ever forget it, because here's the answer to the whole, here's a scoop right here. So Bill reaches down, pulls out his billfold, which is all stuffed and crammed full of old papers and cards and clippings, everything but money in there, see? And he pulls all this debris out in a pile, and he finally comes a little piece of paper, and he hands it to me. And on this paper was a Bible verse. And I looked at this Bible verse, and I looked at this big gorilla, and I thought, well, maybe they've let him out too soon. But anyway, Bill gives me this, and it's one of my very favorite verses. It was a 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse. And it reads, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. That had a tremendous impact on me. Any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And this was our approach to this in the old Oxford group. A new life. Everything passed away. Everything gone. This is our approach in AA. Now, where we supplanted a lot of things the Oxford group had, we had to, because we had to have something here that had more of a universality to it than the Oxford group did. I was talking to some of the boys here tonight about that, and one of the reasons why we had to break away from the Oxford group people. It would have automatically eliminated a lot of people who deserved to have this. Some certain religions couldn't stand for some of the forms and ceremonies that were peculiar to the Oxford group. When this AA program was written, we could go along without these objectionable items in the Oxford group program. So we use this 12-step program as a means of changing our lives. Let us go over these steps. You probably have heard interpretations of the 12 steps before. But let me say this. I'm very fortunate that I was there when these were written. I was there when the book was written, and I know the intent of these steps. Perhaps I have a little different slant on them than some people have, or that you have heard before. I would like to give you some of my slant and interpretation of these steps, which is our program and which is our way of survival. In the Oxford group, we felt there had to be certain things present in order to change. There had to be a need for a change. Well, there has to be a need for a change here. If we're alcoholics and we know it, then if we want to do something about it, we've got the wherewithal to do it. So this program, in my mind, is broken down into four phases. The phases of admission, phase of submission, phase of restitution, and the phase of construction. The phase of admission is contained in the first step. It says, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Well, this was not difficult for me. The evidence was overwhelming. I was powerless over alcohol, and my life was unmanageable. So there is a step of admission. Well, fine, we admitted we're powerless over alcohol, so what? The next thing, what do we want to do about it? And what can we do? Now, this is what tells us what we can do. The next phase is our phase of submission, where we submit ourselves, our lives, and our wills to the care of God. Second step says we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. We came to believe. It doesn't say we believed when we arrived here. Lots of people come into AA. I've seen people come into AA and they fought this thing for a long, long time about believing anything like this. And Lord help them. I can understand it. I can sympathize with them. And I don't hold any brief for them either. I'm not against any of this. But we have to come to believe if we're going to accept this program. You might have some other program you have in mind, but this is the AA program I'm talking about. I'm not talking about BB or XX. This is AA. This program here says we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. I'm not worried about that sanity bit. That sounds good to me. I'm glad I was nuts. Because of some of the things I did, I would have hated to have done it and not be nuts. Believe me. Now, I couldn't help myself. I tried. Other people tried. But I was told by these people whom I met, these alcoholics who preceded me in Akron, that this power had helped them. My sponsor told me it had helped him. So, okay. I wanted to quit. I wanted to do something about it. So I came to believe it could help me too. I might say that when I came to this fellowship, all these men were considerably older than I was. I just passed 35 when I came to this program. And these men were all up in the 40s and 50s. And if this thing could help them after the lives they had, it certainly could do something for me. Third step says, we made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God. Boy, that's asking an awful lot from a rummy. And unless that rummy hurts real bad, he's not going to go for this deal at all. Unless he means business. We're starting to separate the men from the boys now, see? As I said before, no rummy's going to change till he hurts real bad, till he feels a certain way. And if he feels badly enough, he isn't going to squawk too much about this. If he squawks too much, it's too bad. Eventually, he has to come to this if he wants help in AA. We come to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity and so forth. We made this decision. Making a decision is rough for an alcoholic. We are the most indecisive people in the world. We decide we're going to meet you on the corner of 9th and Euclid here at tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock. We'll probably meet you at 20th and some other street, 11 o'clock next October. Some guy might come along with a jug, and now all the bets are off. Everything changes. So this decision to turn our will and our life over to the care of a God, some ethereal creature in the dark blue yonder out here, of whom we have very little acquaintanceship and we're probably scared to death of, this is asking a lot. And believe me, if we're not ready, we're not going to go for this. So this is it. The fourth step, it says, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Now, I think that step has to be taken with the help of someone. I don't think there's any alcoholic worthy of the name who has the capacity to take that step. Because the capacity we have for justifying ourselves is too much. And we are very apt to gloss over the things that we should be dealing with on this inventory deal. So I think we need a sponsor or some knowledgeable, sympathetic person from AA to help us in this inventory. And the next step suggests that that someone was at our elbow. Now this inventory, let me get this straight. This doesn't say anything about we have to stand up and tell every sin we committed, every indiscretion we committed. God knows we can't remember everything we did. I know some of the most interesting things that happened to me. I have no recollection. Somebody told me about it. How can I remember all these things? I can't even remember my middle name now sometimes till I get out of here. This is impossible. But it says something here about these nature of our wrongs and all that sort of thing. That's what we're having to do, is to deal with the nature of our wrongs. The next step here says that we admit it to God and to ourselves and to another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. That's what it says in that step. Not the wrongs themselves, the nature of them. This is important for us to know. That step suggests that someone is there because we admit it to ourselves and to God and to another human being, this guy at our elbow here. See? This is important. The next step here, it says, we were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Boy, that's something, isn't it? Ever hear it like that before? We were entirely ready. It doesn't say we were kind of ready, or about to be, or we were just about ready, or almost ready. It says we were entirely. An alcoholic does everything entirely. And he has to do this entirely. And he's ready to have what? To have God remove him. We can't remove him. And remove all of these defects of character. This is tough. You have to mean business on this deal. But oh, what dividends we get if we go ahead in the right way with this. The next step, it says, we humbly asked him to remove our shortcomings. No deal. We didn't make any deal with God. We didn't say, God, if you do this, I'll do this, and so forth, like we used to do. Not a bit. We humbly asked him to remove them. That takes care of the submission. I would say that we pretty well have submitted our lives and our wills to the care of God by the time we get that far. Something is happening to us. Something has really taken place within us by this time. And if we're still here and with it, then we go on to this inventory proposition, the restitution. This restitution is the steps 8 and 9. That's the third phase. Says we made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. That attitude of willingness to make amends to everyone is what's important in this step. Obviously, we can't make amends to everyone because we don't know everyone we've harmed. A lot of people are no longer available. But we have to have that attitude of willingness to face these people. Then the next step said we made direct amends wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. I think this restitution requires someone to help us. I don't think we can do this ourselves. I don't think it's a safe thing to do. We can make, in our first blush of enthusiasm in AA, you know, when we're in that 3-month period when we can write a better book, we can run a better group, we can do everything better, and I don't know how all these stupid birds got along all this time before I got here. When we get into this thing, boy, a lot of funny things can happen. Serious things can happen. I think there are certain stages an alcoholic goes through. I think the first 3 months is a very critical stage, because I've always said that after, by this time, he can write a better book and he can run a better group than anybody. He was really it. If he lives through that, and he gets up to about 9 months, there's another period there that could be pretty sticky. Because he's been in long enough now that there has been a lot of people who have come in after him, and he is starting to get pontifical. And he looks down his nose at some of these new ones, and he tells them how they should clean the ashtrays, and they should do this, and they should do that. And he is well nigh a real veteran by then, and they better listen to him, because he's Mr. AA. This is 9 months. Well, if he lives through that, there's another period which comes at a year. Now, this year period of danger is more applicable to the periodic AA than it is the chronic. Fortunately, I was a chronic AA. I was drunk all the time. I didn't have to suffer through some of these things that the periodics did. I just used to, in the morning, get up and belt away at it, and I'd get back in the same that I was before, and I didn't have to suffer through all these things that the periodic did. But the periodic at a year, he's never made this year. You see, a year is a time element that has been disastrous to him. It throws rocks in his way. He's signed pledges for a year. He's sworn off for a year. He's signed on New Year's Day. He's going to drink all this year. Then he's been sentenced to a year. And all this year business, you know, it's a block in his capacities here. So this monkey's never made this year. And when he does finally make it in AA, sometimes the guy thinks, well, I have arrived. I have something now that never I had before. Something has happened to me. I am okay now. And he can rest back on his oars. This sometimes happens. I don't need so many meetings. I don't have to hang around so many of these jugheads. I don't like to listen to all this yak, yak, yak that they're all going on about how drunk they got all these years. I've heard all the stories. So this all goes through his mind. And he's starting to get busy in other things anyway. He's gotten back to church maybe. He's got a job. And he's got a little jingle in a pocket. He's got a new car. He's got a new wife. And everything is going, you know, and he's getting to be a pretty important guy in the community, and he's outgrowing these things, so he's had his year, and he can take things easy now and lead a normal life, you know. I just love to see these poor suckers that try out this normal life business. If you think you're ever going to live a normal life in AA, what is a normal life anyway? You know, a normal life for a rummy is to be drunk. Don't ever forget that when they start talking about normalcy. That's our normal state of affairs. Now, if the rummy lives through this year thing, there's another critical period which comes at 2 years. By this time, things have happened pretty well for him. He's getting settled down pretty well, and he sits down one day and gets thinking about this thing. And all of a sudden, he comes to the conclusion that he don't know a bloody thing about this yet. That, to me, is the beginning of wisdom. This guy knows that he has a long ways to go yet, at 2 years. He's been going to his meetings, he's been working hard, he's been running around helping wherever he could and doing what he could, he's been conscientious. He finds out after 2 years, he's just beginning, he's just getting his feet wet. After 3 years of constant effort and attention, and interest, and love, and study, and exercise. Just then does the average alcoholic start to get to the place where he can become logical. After 3 years, and this is after a lot of work. Don't ever forget this. I didn't read this in a book. I have seen thousands and thousands and thousands of alcoholics come to AA. I know thousands and thousands of them all over the country and elsewhere. And I've seen this experience. I've lived through it. And this is about the way it goes. I'm not talking about you geniuses out here. I'm talking about the average rummy who comes here. They're just a slob like myself. Of course, we get geniuses. But we have to excuse them. Now, we have gone through admission, submission, and restitution. This restitution is tough. We have to go to people. Two of the roughest restitution jobs I had, one was with my own brother, and the other was with a bartender. And I had to do this, and I'm glad I did. They're both passed away and gone now. And I'm glad I had that chance, but I did it. It was a rough deal, it really was. It wasn't easy. A lot of people I went to and see, they say, okay, you quit drinking, just stay away from me, that's all right. I won't bother you, just don't you bother me. We'll get along, just stay away. A good many of them says, well, that's fine, Clarence, that's swell. Glad to hear it, and good luck. A lot of people told me that, most of them did. But everyone doesn't accept us, but we have to try this. That's what the program calls for. We have to clean up all this garbage if we can. We have to make the effort and be willing at least. The last phase of our program is a phase of construction. We've had the admission where we know that there's something wrong. We've submitted our will and our lives to the care of God. We've made our restitution. We've cleaned up the past and dropped it. Let the dead past bury its dead, as the good book says. Now we have to construct a life. There's one thing of getting sober. There's a guy says, that's easy to quit drinking. I quit 1,000 times. Yeah, it is easy to quit. Staying quit is a trick. And here's the way we stay quit, is these last three steps. These are the steps I prefer to refer to as the steps of construction. The 10th step, it says we continue to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, we promptly admitted it. Well, that's really a switch for a rummy to ever admit he's wrong. And do it promptly yet. This is something. We've had to grow a lot before we ever get to that 10th step, believe me. So we would never admit anything. We don't even admit it's raining outside. It might involve us in something. I suppose some of you folks have on occasion gone down out of curiosity to a courtroom just to hear cases. You've never been down there as a principal or anything. But we do get down once in a while. It's our civic duty to find out what's going on. So you see some lush come up there in front of the judge in the morning, and he's all blurry-eyed, and he's shaking, and he's sick, and he's scared, and he's sweating, and he stinks. And he's probably been in a can all night, and he don't look so good anywhere you look at him. And they read off the charge there. The bailiff reads it, and the judge looks at him and says, you were drunk. No. No. You were drinking. Well, after a lot of haggling around, this guy will finally break down and admit that he had 2 beers. This is the undoing of the drinker, 2 beers. I have never heard of anybody getting in trouble really getting drunk. It's only those guys that had 2 beers. So I would advise anybody to refrain from that. No, we won't admit anything. Never have, but here this 10th step is requiring that every day we take a personal inventory of ourselves. We have to check on ourselves time and again during the day. Why do we do this, and why do we admit promptly when we're wrong? This is the reason for this. It takes us off the defensive. We've been on the defensive all our lives. That's why we've always skirted around. Every time someone asks us a question, we parry it, you know. I can remember when I came into AA, I lay in that hospital in Akron for a week. And every day, some of these men came in to see me. They come in and visited me, and everyone told me their story. And everyone told me the same thing before he left. He says he has the answer to my drinking problem. But none of them would tell me what the answer was. They were leaving that up to my sponsor, see? The guy that was going to operate on me. The last day I was in this hospital, Paul Stanley came in. Paul's dead now, Paul and Dick both. And Paul could really talk. Wow. Paul's wife was a Christian Science reader, and Paul had got inoculated with some of this Christian Science. He got it mixed up with Oxford Group stuff, and he'd been reading Emmett Fox, and he got into spiritualism. And he got to talking to me. He came in. I'm in the bed. I might say I weighed 130 pounds when I was in that hospital, so you know I was pretty sick. I hadn't eaten for a long time. And this is the last day I'm in the hospital. I'd been in there about a week, I guess. And Paul came in at breakfast time. He came in early. Didn't have anything else to do. And he ate my breakfast for me. Good fellow. Paul was still talking to me at lunchtime. You fellas in Cleveland, and all you people know about this hospitalization they do up in that part of the country, and a lot of people around here do the same, I guess. So Paul was in there at lunchtime, and he ate my lunch for me. I got the dessert. But the point is, I wasn't even eaten yet. I was in there a week and I hadn't started to eat, so you can imagine how shape I was in. And he's still talking to me, and I'm still, Well, about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Doc came in, and Paul left. He missed my supper. So Doc came in, and he sat on the foot of the bed in a very unprofessional posture. And he looks at me. And any of you folks who knew Doc, and a good many of you here I know have had the pleasure of meeting him before he died. Doc was a tall, angular fella, and he had fingers on him about this long. And Doc sat there a minute, he looked at me, he says, "Well, young fellow," he says, "what do you think of all this by now?" He says, I says, "Well, I think this is fine. All these fellas coming in talking to me, I don't know any of them from a load of hay, but they're all telling me there's what happened to them, and they're all so good to me." And I says, "It's wonderful. I think it's great." I says, "But there's one thing that gets me." He says, "Well, what's that?" I says, "These fellas keep telling me that they have the answer to my problem, but they won't tell me what this is." I says, "Just what is this answer? What's the secret? What do I have to do? What are you going to do to me?" So I'll never forget this. He looks at me and he says, "Well, young fella," he says, "we don't know about you. We don't know if you're ready yet. 130 pounds, I'm on the bum, I don't have any place to go, I'm broke, I don't know where I'm going when I leave that hospital. And he don't know if I'm ready." I often contrast that with the idea the way we kiss some of these monkeys nowadays. Oh, come on. I had to fight my way into this deal, really. So what's to get ready? I had to convince him I was ready for this. Finally, I guess I did, because he says, "Okay," he says, "I'll give you the answer to this whole thing." He turns to me then with his long bony finger and he points it at me. And he says, "Young fella," he says, "do you believe in God?" Well, boy, this really shook me. Because this is the last thing I ever expected to hear from a doctor. I expected something quite different, as I explained before. So this guy, this shook me up, and of course, being a rummy, I can't answer a question like that without parrying, you know. So I look back at him, I'm amazed, of course, and I says, "Well, what does that have to do with it?" He says, "Young fella, that has everything to do with it. Do you or don't you?" This is giving you the spiritual foundation and with a silk glove, I guess, huh? With a hammer. So I'm flabbergasted. I don't want to answer this because things went through this blubber of mine. I thought, holy smokes, I'm in this hospital. I'm obligated to a bunch of religious nuts. See, last thing I want to get tangled up with. So he's waiting for an answer. Do I or don't I? So I says, "Well, I guess I do." He says, "There's no guessing about it. You do or you don't." Well, I'm stuck. Where can I go? So I said, "Okay, I believe in God. Yes, I do." He says, "Fine." He says, "Now we can get someplace." I thought, oh boy, we're going to get someplace. He says, "Get out of there and get on your knees." So he bounces me out of that bed and I get on my knees. He says, "We're going to pray." I says, "Who's going to pray?" He says, "You're going to pray." I says, "I don't know anything about praying." He says, "I don't expect you do, but," he says, "I'll utter a prayer and you can repeat it and that'll do for this time." So he got me down there on my bones in that hospital room and he uttered a prayer and I followed him. I felt foolish, of course, naturally. I felt like a fish. But it didn't kill me. As you see, I am here. And after we concluded, he shook my hand. He says, "Young fellow, you're going to be all right." And that night he carried me off to a meeting, and that was my beginning. I just wanted to mention that because it ties in here about what this program is and about this changing of our lives. This next step, the 11th step, is a very important step. because it starts us on a prayer life. This 10th, 11th, and 12th steps are the steps of construction. Remember, I mentioned that before. This is where we're constructing a life. In order to live by spiritual principles, we have to learn how to talk and communicate and listen to God. And it doesn't make any difference what our religion is or what our persuasion is or whether we have any at all, or if we've strictly fallen away from all that. This 11th step cannot offend anyone. This is our beginning in a prayer life, in our communication with this power who is helping us and has taken away all these things and is forgiving us and is giving us this new life so that all things have become new. This is where we learn to communicate. Listen to this 11th step. It's so important for you and I. It's written in very plain language. There's nothing that is concealed. It says, sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God, praying only for knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that out. Just listen to that. Break that down a little bit. What are we seeking here in our prayer? We sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God. That's all. What are we praying for? Are we praying for a new job, a new wife, or a new house, or for sobriety? Nothing like that. It doesn't say anything like that. You don't see anything about sobriety in this whole program. It says we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God. We want a conscious contact with Him. We want to be able to meet Him, talk with Him, feel Him, express ourselves to Him, listen to Him, get orders and directions from Him. It says praying only for knowledge of His will for us. We want to know what God wants us to do. His will, not ours. This is so important. And we're praying for the power to carry this out. The good book tells us that He will never give us any task but what He gives us the power to see it through. This step tells us this too. Tells us what to pray for, how to pray and what to pray for. Very simple. Would that prayer offend anyone in this room? How could it? If you've never prayed, this is a good way to begin. The 12th step, let's listen to this step. Here's a step that's probably the most maligned one in the whole kit and caboodle. You hear people talking about 12-stepping this and 12-stepping that. What is the 12th step? What does it say? What does it require? It says in this 12th step, having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps. Remember, it assumes we've gone through these steps and taken them conscientiously and done something with them. It says, and as a result of that, we had a spiritual experience. Now, what is a spiritual experience? It's very simple. I don't think there's any person in his room, except when he had DTs, ever heard whistles blown and bells ringing and lights flashing and something come and clobber him real hard. No, this isn't the way spiritual experiences happen. If any person has had this kind of a spiritual experience, it usually fades out about as fast as it came. A spiritual experience is a change of heart, and something comes into us. Something replaces something that was here that we don't need anymore. It's a change of heart, a change of mind, a change of attitude, a change of person, if you please. We are different people. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. The old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. This step here, it says, we, having had a spiritual experience, a change, that thing happened to us because we took these steps. It says, as a result of these steps, it isn't just because someone hypnotized us or brought us in here and took us to a meeting and says, just sit here, this will rub off on you. That's the biggest bunch of hogwash I ever heard. AA isn't going to rub off on anybody. AA has to be rubbed into you, not on you. This is a big difference. And how it gets in us is through the acceptance and through our giving. Now, having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to other alcoholics and to practice these principles in all of our affairs. people say to me, when should I go out and do 12-step work? When should I go out? Read your 12-step. What does it say? It says, having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, then we tried to carry this message to other alcoholics. We carry this message when we have a message to carry, if you please. That's what's fouling up so much of AA today. A bunch of birds are carrying something they don't have. I say, if I have measles, I can give you measles. If I've got whooping cough, I can give you that. If I don't have measles, I can give you no measles. If I have no whooping cough, I can't give you that either. If I don't have a message of AA to give you, if it hasn't happened to me, how can I share it with you? I don't have it to share. I don't say that new people shouldn't go out on 12-step calls, but they should go out with their sponsors, people who have had this experience. Then everybody learns something. Everybody shares. Think about this sometime. Let me know if you have an argument with that. I don't see how you could. Let's carry what we have. Let's be sure we have something. And it's here for all of us. We are the chosen people. We have been tapped for this. We've been touched. There is no person I have ever met in Alcoholics Anonymous, whether he has made this right from the start or not, that hasn't been a changed person. Something's happened to him. If nothing else, it spoiled his drinking for him. You and I have seen this many times. This is not unusual. I'm a lucky one. I never had any drinking trouble after I come to AA. When I quit, I was done. I had mine. And I was very fortunate in this. But a lot of people are not that fortunate. Something happened along the line that they just didn't get taught properly. They weren't brought in it properly. Or maybe they weren't proper for it at the time. I don't know. A lot of reasons. But you and I have seen people who come into this thing years ago. And they batted themselves around and got hurt for, and hurt a lot of other people, including themselves, for a number of years. And then eventually, something let go in them. And this program and this feeling and this spirit took hold of them. And they became sober and become great inspirations. This happens. This AA isn't just a pattern that everyone sits down and does the same thing and succeeds in the same way. We don't all communicate exactly the same way. We all, as Julian said, he come up here and talk to some of you Yankees. He don't know what most of you're talking about. He can't understand you. He knows something about it. He does have one basis of understanding. That's in our alcoholism and our membership here. Believe me, he understands everything about that in you. He may not be able to understand Yankee language, which is not important. We can communicate with people who can't even speak the English language. We can get along and have fellowship and love with them. And we do in many places. But this 12th step summarizes what has happened because we have accepted this step and taken it and done something. Now we're living. This is the greatest program ever devised. This is terrific. It's a great privilege to belong to it and to be chosen for it. I consider myself a very fortunate person. I've had, for many years, a real happiness in this. I'm a younger man now than I was when I came here 25 years ago. Much younger. Because I had pictures of myself that were taken. A guy took movies of me about 3 years before I quit drinking. I wish you'd see those movies. And I was an old man. Believe me. I can do things now I couldn't do then, by a long shot. And I have a new life. I enjoy it. I want to get the most out of it I can. You and I all have the same privilege. We are indeed the chosen people. I thank you very much for listening.